Steven Espinosa, we're seconds after the amazing press conference. Javante Tank Davis, he's over your shoulder. Rolando Romero, it was fireworks from the get-go. You called his coaching name. What goes through your mind right now? How excited are you for May 28th?
Look, there are multiple reasons. I mean, one, this is an exciting fight. I mean, we know what Tank does. We know what Rolly does. There's not, I think in this one, it's very personal. I don't think there's a lot of science going on in this fight. You know, those guys were nearly every punch. They're trying to take you out. So, there's no question, there's no mystery about how this fight's going to go. But, you know, I'm as excited to be back in Brooklyn. Brooklyn's been a critical part of the growth of the sport of boxing in the New York City area. And the pandemic interrupted that, a change in ownership. I think there's a real opportunity to, you know, put boxing back on the map, you know, show the new ownership here at Barclays Center that, you know, this is a sport they should continue to invest in. So I think it's on all of us boxing fans in the New York City area on the East Coast. You know, we send a message, you know, and the best way to send a message is, you know, where you spend your money. And we support this event. You know, I'm confident that Barclays Center will be back in boxing just as active as they were before the pandemic.
You have so many great fights coming up on Showtime. This is one of them. Of course, you have Charlo Castano too. I visited both of them in camp, but we're in for a major treat. Dremel is a man on a mission. What do you think? May 14th.
I love that fight. I mean, it's something we've been looking forward to since last July. You know, at times it looked like it wouldn't happen. There were obstacles with sanctioning bodies, you know, but ultimately you got everybody in line because it's a great opportunity. It's a great opportunity for the sport, and stylistically it's a great fight. You know, look, this weekend we've got Erickson Lubin and Fandora looking to position themselves for the winner. And that's an even money fight. I mean, literally an even money. Last I checked, Lubin Fandora was exactly the same odds on either one of them.
It's a great fight.
And, you know, and honestly, I haven't seen the odds for Charlo Castano, but they're not going to be very slanted one way or the other. Anybody who tells you they know how that fight's going to go, you know, isn't being honest, because I think that's anybody's fight.
Another great fight with a lot of belts on the line is Errol Spence Ugas. The buildup is insane. People are excited. What can we expect on fight night?
Well, look, that's another great atmosphere. I mean, we're north of 30,000 tickets.
Wow.
And we still got 10 days to go before the fight. And that shows the kind of interest because, you know, top to bottom, I mean, that I'd like to think of that as really, you know, in terms of the TV fights, it's a six-fight card, really, because you get Budiev, Stanionis, and Brandon Lee, Zach Ochoa on Showtime before the pay-per-view. So all in all, for your pay-per-view money, you're getting six fights with some interesting stuff on the undercard. You have the return of Isak Cruz, who a lot of, you know, people just discovered when he fought Tank. And I think it's going to be a really exciting night. There's six TV-quality fights on that card.
Speaking of undercards, I'm going to ask you, and you don't have to answer. The Fury Dillian Whyte has the worst undercard in the history of my boxing career in 13, 15 years. Why is that?
It's a good question. I mean, there's certainly talent there. You know, those promoters have access to talent, you know, and whether it's, you know, I don't know their business. I can only speculate. I'm not sure if it was, you know, but there's so much money tied up in the main event. They didn't want to make the investment, go further on the risk, on a limb, on a risk. But I think it's a missed opportunity. I mean, that's one thing that's been a priority for us last year and especially this year. And that's why we're seeing three fights down. We have world title fights. You know, we've got eliminators, you know, co-features. And we're really trying to avoid, you know, those announcements when the fight comes out and you've got, you know, a star on one side and a guy you literally have to Google on the other. You know, that's not what we're doing. We're looking at evenly matched fights, former title challengers, up-and-coming contenders, evenly matched fights. And we've seen it. I mean, we saw it with Chris Colbert, you know, a big upset early in the year. And then there have been others as well. You'd probably call Megzio an upset as well. So, you know, that's what happens when people take tough fights. You can't always predict what's going to end, and I think that's something we're proud of. And we look at that card, we look at other cards, I'm constantly shocked, you know, at the lack of care that's taken to undercards. You know, literally, for guys like you and me to have to say, Google somebody or say, like, who is that? That's saying a lot. And if you're putting that on as your co-feature, you know, that's a problem.
Jake Paul mentioned he's coming back in August. Would that be on Showtime?
I hope so. We're in conversations with Jake. You know, trying to work out your opponent and the finances. I think, you know, for us, it's been a very positive thing to be in business with him, and we'd love to continue.
A couple more fights coming up. Shakur Valdez, what do you think? Winner will have two belts at 130.
Yeah, it's a good question. You know, I think Valdez has the, you know, not as quick and as athletic as Shakur, but we've seen it before. Like, sometimes the pressure, you know, and just the fundamentally sound, I think it's a tough fight. I think, you know, really whoever can really impose their power, their will on this, I give Valdez, you know, a decent chance of that.
I talked to Jamal Charlo. He said that him and Canelo, they already were in advanced talks. Obviously, Canelo did, he chose Bivol. So first, what do you think of Bivol, Canelo? How close was Canelo Charlo to happening?
It was very close, and it was the more lucrative offer of the two. And even when it turned into a Tula fight offer, it was the PBC offer was more lucrative than the other one. And look, at the end of the day, you know, Canelo is an experienced guy. He knows what he wants in his career. And if the challenge was there, you know, for him for the taking, you know, that's clearly was attractive to him. Personally, obviously, I'm not objective, but I think in terms of the perception and the fan reaction, I think there's more excitement around Charlo than Benavidez. But I'm not going to say that it's not an exciting fight. That's a challenging fight. 175 is, you know, it's a tough division. And Bivol is a legitimate 175-pounder. So there's definitely challenge there. And I hope, you know, that there's enough that, you know, after the Bivol fight, you know, we can pick up those conversations and still get it done.
A couple more and I'm done. Adrian Broner, any news, any updates?
Adrian's in camp.
Yes, he's working hard.
Which is new.
Yeah.
You know, and he's gone away. He's in Colorado for camp. You know, demonstrating how serious he is. And we're working on opponents and dates for him. But, you know, he's clearly committed to it. I think he's still got gas in the tank. I think they're interesting matchups. And, you know, whether you love him or whether you hate him, you know.
You're going to watch him.
You know, he's still a draw.
Okay, last thing. Message to fans. Gervonta Davis, Rolando Romero. Rolly right here with this 1 out of 1. $7,000 with that suit.
$7,000 suit, and that's not even counting the fur either.
what do you tell people about this?
Look, it's pretty simple. Like, sometimes you can strip all the storylines away and the belts and the, you know, the rankings and all this, and it's just, you know, like Tank said, about respect. You know, this is it's a fight where we know what both guys are going to do. They're going to try and knock each other out with virtually every punch. You know, it's not. There's not going to be any surprises. There's no deception here. They're both going to say, let's go to the center of the ring and see who can take the other's best shot. And, you know, I think that's exciting. You know, I think when you get one of those, you know, and you know there's very personal, and this is, you know, not about money or legacy or titles. It's about a personal rivalry that's developed. I think that adds a lot of excitement to the fight.
It's a major fight at 135. Another fight is Devin Haney-Kambosos. What do you think? Who wins?
You know, it's a good question. Whenever you have an upset like we saw, you know, like Kambosos Teofimo, you have to wonder, you know, was that more about Kambosos or was it more about Teofimo? You know, and the only way we'll see is to see Kambosos against another high-level opponent. You know, so we'll see it. You know, obviously, Haney is definitely skilled. And it'll be interesting. It should be a good style matchup. With the pressure of Kambosos and the movement, athleticism of Haney, you know, it could be there. But, for me, I think the jury's still out on Kambosos. Not going to discount what he did. He was by far the better man on that night. We've since learned that Teofimo had some pretty serious health problems. So I think the question is, you know, how much of that was Teofimo and how much was Kambosos. So I think that's why people are interested in these high-level matchups with Kambosos, is to see how good is he really.
All right, we'll stay tuned. Everybody, May 28th on Showtime. Don't miss it. Pay-per-view, Gervonta Davis, Rolando Romero. Steven, where do people follow you?
Twitter, Steven Espinosa.
Thank you so much. Elie Sixpack reporting.